All right, we're ready to roll.
Where were we? Oh, I was in the
You had just cleaned up your jacket.
I cleaned up my boots and my jacket, and the runner came in, and the lieutenant screamed at everybody there, "We're going to the front line." I said to him, "I don't even have a gun." He says, "Here, take my radio." I was his radio man. Now, this was Lieutenant Wolf. I didn't know his name because I had never seen him before. So we went up to the front line and was in a sort of a depression with trees along the depression. We were in sight of the tanks coming up the hill towards us and the infantry behind them. He had a 45. I don't know what, think he had anything else. I had no weapon. And the guys beside us, not really real close to us, fired a few shots, but nobody had told them to fire, so they quit. And all of a sudden, behind me, a German poked a gun in my back and said, "Raus." Now, I knew what Raus meant, and I have no, didn't, at that time, I had no idea how that German ever got behind me, because I'm watching the infantry out in front and the tank. And how he got there, I don't know. But the tank stopped, and the infantry stopped. And immediately, the infantry came forward and took us. This one guy was behind us, and we stood up and dropped our guns. I had the radio and so on. And so then they started marching us back toward their line. And going down across this field, I could see, heck, I'm not the only one, Lieutenant Wolf and I. There was a whole bunch going down the same way. And they took us down to a flat section along the road where I had my machine gun set up behind one of their tanks that had already been knocked out. And they were assembling us. In the process, I don't know how many of us, there must have been 40, 45 of us that they had collected, the 3rd platoon, the 2nd platoon. I was the only one from the 1st platoon, and that was because I had been in the company headquarters overnight. An American shell came in and hit in the middle of us. It killed a number of our guys. Lieutenant Wolf, Bull Durham, who else? Tiedemann got very badly shot. Hendricks, or Captain Hendricks at that time, got shot. Matthews and I didn't get a scratch. Also, a guy from Cleveland. Him and I tried to get Bull Durham up off the ground. And Bull, we didn't realize it, but Bull was dead. And so we knew then, and you looked around and you see that there was a number of your men dead. But the guards apparently had been back far enough that they didn't have the amount of damage that we had. And so they were, when I got up off the ground, the guard was still pointing a gun at me. So there was no other choice but to stand there. And we went from there. They took us on back towards the thing. I helped Captain Hendricks along because he was hurt. Tiedemann and Matthews were together, and so Matthews took care of Tiedemann, and we were marched back in the German lines into a barn. And we stayed in that barn overnight. The Germans, a German officer who didn't speak English, had an interpreter, and he asked a bunch of questions, and naturally he got virtually no answers. And we stayed there overnight. Surprisingly, the Germans brought some of our K rations in. They had captured them someplace along the line, and they handed out a few boxes of K rations. And so we had a little bit to eat. So then they took a group of us, and I think there was 6 of us, that they 2 German home guard men, that's older men, started us back the road. And we walked for 3 or 4 hours, I suppose. And naturally we were in the Ardennes forest in the woods. And they came to a area where there was some women working. They were cutting trees and getting the wood. And they had an enclosure there, a barbed wire fence enclosure with a little cabin on it. And they put us in there, and the guards, we stood there for a while, and the guards went on about their duty. And they left. And here we were stuck in this compound where these people were cutting trees. And we thought, well, eventually they'll get us out of here and take us on someplace else. Didn't happen. We stayed there overnight, didn't do a thing, no cover, no compound. We're in a barbed wire compound. There is snow on the ground. We're freezing, hungry, everything else you could think of. Daylight came, and they brought two women brought this wagon with some food of some sort in it. I don't remember exactly what we had, but whatever it was warm, and we were satisfied that we had something. So then we were part of their group. We were taken out and told by an older guy, German, that we were to help these women. We didn't get any weapons, no axes or anything like that, no saws, but we had to gather up all the twigs and things that were available and load them onto a wagon. And they had one horse, to pull this wagon, and it was a hell of a load for one horse. It was a double horse wagon, actually. And so we spent about 4 days there helping those women. On the second day, these women...
I'm thirsty.
I bet you are. Gavin, why don't you go watch the movie for a few more minutes, and then we'll have some more soda or something.
I have more soda right now.
Right now?
Yeah.
No, how about in 5 minutes?
Now.
5 minutes.
Now.
All right. Is this? No, where
no,
is yours?
His is over here.
There it is, yeah.
You want to shut that off?
No, yeah, we'll just burn some tape. We'll have some fun.
Okay.
Here you go. Maybe we can coax them back in there. I'm going to turn it down, though. That thing's blaring.
Yeah. Well, Mary can turn it down. She's got the controller.
You're supposed to have that in there, so take a good swig.
Yeah, we don't normally take fluid out of the kitchen.
Yeah, I don't blame you there, especially with this crazy kid. Mm-hmm. All right, go watch your movie, and we'll be done in a couple minutes. Okay. Thank you.
So, we were there, and one day they came along with a carpet that they had got from someplace. And we were able to put that on the ground over the snow so that we had a place to sleep at. So then they brought some more guys in, and they took us older guys, and we started back to another area. How it happened, I don't know, but the one German had spoken some English, one German guard, and I was free to talk to them if possible. And I told him that I'd been raised on a farm and had run a team of horses. We got back so far, and I was signaled out, taken by this one guard, taken onto a temporary airport. At that time, I have no idea of how it happened, but I was told that I would take care of a horse. This horse, I would use the horse to pull a cart, it had an engine on, aircraft engine on, take it over to a repair building, and bring another one back. Then, by means of block and tackle, we would take the horse and lift that engine up to the aircraft. The aircraft were shoved back into the woods as though you couldn't see them. And it was a terrible place because there was so much snow on the ground, and these poor Germans working out there trying to get the engines put back in. And the horse was not really cooperative.
So they were using you as labor.
Right, I was labor.
To work, to put engines back on these airplanes. Uh-huh. Were they fighters?
Yes, yeah. Single engine craft, and okay. Single engine fighters. And then there was times that I just stood there, maybe for an hour or so, holding the horse, waiting on further instructions. And there was no way that I could get away from it, that I could see it, I could just pick up and walk away. Anyhow, that ended in about a week. I think I was there, and I was taken with another group of guys, and I don't know where they came from, and we went on a long, long march overnight. We stopped at a little bit of a shanty overnight, and then we went on, and we came to a village of Fleischmann. Here was a German Army mobile bakery set up. And so we were put in another barn, and hey, I was glad to get in that barn because it was warm, there was enough straw on the ground in the barn that we could sleep comfortably. And so first night, boy, I slept like a log because I hadn't been able to sleep much at the airport. So the trucks would come in at night, loaded with bakery items, whatever it was, sawdust, flour, and so on. Our job was to take the bags off the truck and put them into the storage area, and then take them from the storage area to the mixers, and even to the fact that we would take the bread on these long boards, and the German bakers would put them in the oven. This was great. Second or third night of this, something happened that I missed hold on the bag, or the guy on the truck dumped the bag off on me, and I hurt my back. And I couldn't get up off the ground. So they picked me up, and I went in. They took me in and laid me in beside one of the furnaces to keep me warm. And I stayed there nearly the whole night. And then with some help, I got back into the barn that we had been staying in. And so the guard would come and check on me every so often, just maybe to see if I could work or not. But eventually, I was able to get up and go pretty well. And I worked for a day in their kitchen. I worked cleaning up refuse and keeping a floor and so on. And these cooks were doing cooking. It smelled fabulous, but we didn't get it. So then we moved from there. We moved back to Limburg, Germany. There was a mammoth railroad section there and this fairly large prison compound. This is the point where I was registered as a German prisoner, and I still have the card showing my registration number. At this place, we worked on the railroad. We would, every night, they would take us out and we did something on the railroad. Either we shoveled gravel back into a hole, or we helped carry ties, or we carried rails and so on. Whatever was necessary that they would watch. Then in the daytime, we were taken back to our barracks, given a slice of bread and some soup, what it was. And we in the daytime would look out the window and see that the British came back and bombed out what we had done. So that was that. Then after being there for about a week, I was loaded onto a boxcar. And to my knowledge, if I remember rightfully, we were only 2 days on that boxcar. But there must have been 100 of us in it because we couldn't lay down. There wasn't room enough. And we were taken from someplace during the course of the night, an engine hooked onto us and moved us, and we ended up at this compound called Bad Orb, Stalag 9B, I think it is. And the home guard then would take a half a dozen of us at a time, and each one home guard would march us up the hill and into this prison camp. And so after they had moved the two carload of us up there, a American soldier came out. Then there was always an American soldier in charge of a camp. But he was in full dress uniform, looked like he had never had a bit of trouble, well fed, everything. He told us what the situation was. Well, we were in a room, a large room. We had a stove in the middle, nothing to put in it. This is in January. No, by that time it was March. And so we had nothing to use for blankets or anything by that time. So we would crowd together at night. This was the first time that I knew what bed bugs were. I'd seen louse and crabs and so on, but I had never seen bed bugs. And I mean, bed bugs can eat holes in you in a hurry. And they did. But eventually, the Germans knew, and we knew, we could hear the armor coming through, we could hear the shells, and it was getting closer and closer. And so the Germans, our soldier commander called us all out and got out in the field, route in the compound, and the Germans announced, and the Germans spoke in English. He says, "We are going to leave you. You are here in the compound." They said, "This is fenced in. If you want to leave, you can try." But he said, "You're in such condition that you shouldn't try. Stay here and let the American army come through." It didn't work for some of the guys. They decided to break out anyhow. And they cut the fence and got out, but it didn't get anywhere. And then the next day, the army came in and surrounded the camp, and they knew that we were all POWs in there. And there was not only us, there was some Russians in another, they kept us separated, but there was Russians in the same camp area. And so they started to decide that we needed some food. But they didn't have enough to give us very much. And so the first thing they did was to boil up a bunch of food and give us some better soup than we'd been having. And along with that comes the Red Cross. They're right up on the front line. And they're going to set up their place, and they're going to make coffee and donuts for us. And they did. And everybody got sicker than hell, because your stomachs were not accustomed to the coffee and donuts. So we had diarrhea. Everybody had diarrhea. Anyhow, after that, we were told that we were going to go into a delousing section and leave the camp. And they took us a few at a time. And so we would go into this delousing section. They had set up a tent and got some water somehow. And we go in there, and first thing they did was you took all your clothes off. Then you shaved your head. And then you went into the delousing section, and then you got a shower. And then clean clothes that they had got from someplace. It didn't matter what they were, they fit. And then we walked a little ways and got on trucks. And they hauled us to a temporary airport. And I remember the airport real well, because it had the landing stuff that our army used all the time to make airports, with the metal strips. Got on a plane and was flown to Camp Lucky Strike, which was near Le Havre. And again, we were trucked into this camp. And all of us are still quite sick and not able to do very much. And I was one of the ones that was able to walk around. And some of my buddies were still laying on beds and couldn't hardly get up. And the order came that there was a ship ready to take us someplace. And we weren't feeling worth a darn, but they put us on a ship anyhow. We went from Le Havre to England, Bournemouth. And I was in England on the ship when the Germans surrendered. And there was a great joyous thing, and we had no idea what was going on, but the people on land did, and then eventually we were told that the Germans had capitulated. And the very next day, that ship headed for the United States. On the way back, a lot of us was quite disturbed, because it seemed as though the only thing they had on that ship was pineapple. We got pineapple juice and pineapple and pineapple. And not much food except the pineapple. And to this day, I'm not fond of pineapple. So we then got to New York, came into New York, and we could see the great monument and the Statue of Liberty. And we're taken to a military camp. I don't know which one it was. But anyhow, we were given a thorough inspection, and I had some repair work. He pulled a tooth and did some repair work on my mouth. And from there, we went to Camp Atterbury, got on a train, went to Camp Atterbury, Indiana. We pulled in there, and they started getting us off the train, and my God, there's nobody but German guards. All the German POWs were there to take care of us. And that really went over well with a whole bunch of ex-POW. So anyhow, we lived through it, you're going to. And then they gave us all a 60-day leave that we would go home. And during that 60 days, Mary and I got married, and we went back to, then both of us went back to Miami, Florida, because this was the orders that I had. When we got to Florida, they had no record of me. They didn't know where I existed. So they sent me back to Fort Benning. And I stayed in Fort Benning. That was in August. And I got discharged in October. So I was in Fort Benning for a couple of months doing virtually nothing. The one lieutenant said, "You've got to make a jump." I says, "Why should I make a jump? I'm going to be discharged some of these days as soon as they find the papers." That was my experience on that. And when the time came, the guy said, you're up for discharge. Gather up all your belongings and so on. And he says, "Well, now, wouldn't you like to stay in the Army?" I says, "No way, whatsoever." So I ended that.
And that was the end of your Army experience.
That was the end of my Army experience. In October the 10th, I got out in 45.
Now, you told me about how George cut himself on the 13th or so of June, and that's how he got that first Purple Heart.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Do you have any other things that strike you that with George stateside or overseas, do you remember any stories, anything that might surround him, or was that
actually later? Once we got into Europe, I didn't have much contact with George, and so I can't say that. When we were stateside, we in the barracks, George and I were right close together, and we're good friends. But then once we got into Normandy, I don't remember seeing him during the whole combat. I didn't know about him, where he was, until we were heading back to England. And then I found out that he still had a bandage on, and that's when I found out that he had got the tin can deal. In fact, it was kept pretty quiet that he had got the Purple Heart because of the tin can. And shortly after we got back to the Yenford Lodge, they lined a bunch of them up, the whole company, and presented Purple Hearts to the individuals who had been wounded. And that's when George got his first Purple Heart.
Right. Well, that sounds very interesting, and I really appreciate it, and I'm glad you were nice enough to do a little interview.
Spend some time with you. Huh?
Yeah,
well,
absolutely.
I was very polite, because you are the only younger person that I know that had any interest in whatsoever we did in World War II. Even today, I belong to the Legion. We have two or three of us who were in physical combat in the whole Legion. And the rest of us were veterans that were in the kitchen or tanks or something that never was into physical combat. And they have little to no interest in what we did. And there aren't many of us, infantry or armored or what, left, that were in physical combat.
Well, I thank you.
You're quite welcome.
All right.
Glad you could come this far.